In this video, to give troubleshooting insight, we'll show details of how a sprinkler control valve works, we'll disassemble and clean parts of an Irritriol valve that was sticking open, and we'll demonstrate common points of failure. Good morning. Well, anybody with experience in system repair knows that you need to have a working understanding of how these systems work before you have any hope of solving problems. To that end, I need you to give me 3 minutes of your time to go over some schematics, following which we'll move on to a real-world repair of a valve that won't shut off. Here's a cross-section of a sprinkler control valve in its closed position. Water comes in from the main supply right here, so you have constant pressure in this area 24 hours a day. I'm showing the water as blue dots. The diaphragm is shown in green, and it seals the lip right here. When the diaphragm moves up against this spring and water pressure, water can follow this pathway around the outside going to the sprinkler heads. So the zone lines are mostly empty of water and full of air except when running. Now what would happen if you had a grain of sand lodged right at the lip here? Yeah, you'd have a low volume continuous leak, usually presenting as a wet patch of grass around the lowest sprinkler head of the zone. You might think of it as a bad sprinkler head, but the problem is right here. These diaphragms all have a small pathway that allows water to trickle over to the other side of the valve, to the top part of the valve. I've shown that pathway right here. So water will flow along that narrow pathway until you have equal pressure on each side of the valve. But here's the deal. The area of the valve exposed to water pressure on the top is much larger than the area below. Imagine the green valve was a door, and you had 10 men trying to push the door up. Above the door, you had 100 men pushing the door down. Even though the pressure above and below is the same, that door stays shut until pressure above is reduced. The only way the valve is going to open is if you somehow reduce pressure above the valve. These valves do that by having a manual pathway, a bypass pathway that I've shown here and here. This is the brains of the system, the manual control bushing, and this is the solenoid. The manual control bushing is threaded into place and it allows two pathways to decompress the system. It's normally cranked right down, so water normally can't go through this little passageway right here. But when you unscrew it, the bottom contact lifts off this little seat and water can move through this way. As a rule, I always unscrew all of these manual control bushings in the winter so trapped water can't freeze and damage adjacent parts. It's a common question in the spring. People ask me why their system isn't working and remind them that all the manual control bushings have to be cranked right down. If even one zone is not, the system can't mount enough water pressure in the main supply to power the other zones. When the manual control bushing is cranked right down, the other pathway is through a passage inside the bushing to the top part right here. You notice the solenoid is closing off another little nipple here. Now when power goes to that solenoid, it lifts up and allows the water to decompress through this little pathway right here and down to the zones. So fair enough. Now what would you expect if you got a grain of sand lodged, say, right here or right here, where water could get around, but the devices couldn't close down completely? Yeah, that's a valve that's going to stick open. It's not going to close down properly. What if you got a clot of dirt, say here or here, preventing any passage through those decompression tubes? What would happen then? Yeah, you'd have a valve that wouldn't open, either with the solenoid or with manual control.
Well, that's enough theory. Today we've got a sprinkler zone that won't shut off. In the spring when I activated the system, all of the zones seemed to work normally with the controller. But on this particular zone, when the controller moved to the next zone, this zone stayed on. And so we had two zones that were activated, and of course, the system can't handle two zones on at the same time. What do you think the problem is?
This is an Irritriol system. Let me identify the parts. This is the anti-siphon valve. You can see it's dripping a little bit right now. That's coming from the anti-siphon here. I'm not too worried about that. This is the solenoid. This is a manual control valve. And I've got it completely off right now. So the system shouldn't be flowing, but it is. This is the flow control valve, and this is the one that controls the rate of flow for the system. I generally leave them all open. And this is my manual bleed screw. So with the system pressurized, the first thing I'm going to do is I'm going to undo this manual control valve right here, just to try and flush the system out. Now you don't want to undo this all the way, because you can have water everywhere. Remember, we're pressurized. So I'm just going to flush this out, and the idea is that if there are little rocks or debris or stones in the system, it may help to dislodge that. Now that we have the main water turned off, we can safely disassemble this without getting soaked. First thing I'm going to do is I'm going to unscrew the solenoid and get it out of my way. It would be unusual for a solenoid problem to cause this. And I think that we're dealing with an electrical, or we're not dealing with an electrical issue, because the system turns on fine. So here's our solenoid. And that little button in there moves up and down. It moves freely. When this is energized, that button moves upward to allow flow to decompress the area above the valve. It seems to be normal. Now we'll take off the manual control bushing, and we're going to unscrew this part here. Like so. There's a little debris in there. I'm just going to clean that out. Let's put this aside. Now you need to make sure that little button is not lost. We'll just keep an eye on it here. The mechanism that these systems use to drive the system is really interesting. Here's what the manual control bushing screws into. Looking down, you can see two holes. The center hole has a raised seat and it leads to the zone, and the side hole leads to the bonnet above the diaphragm. I suppose you could use a paperclip to see if the center one is patent, but I wouldn't do that to the side port of this device, because in this design, if I push in too far, I could accidentally puncture the diaphragm. We're going to take the bonnet right off, so it makes sense to probe that later. So there's my bonnet and spring. And indeed, you can see there is some asymmetry there. This little bump mates with that little hole right there. So we'll need to be careful to put it back in exactly the same way. So now let's get this diaphragm out. I think this diaphragm is toast. I'm just going to carefully peel it off here. Still functional, very dirty. Let's clean it up. Okay, what I'm looking for is rocks and debris that might be near the lip of the sealing surfaces. I'm not seeing anything, but it certainly is very grungy, and it seems to have lost some flexibility as well. There's all this calcification on here we're going to have to clean off, but the actual sealing surfaces look fine. Now there could be rocks and debris down deep in the system, so I like to flush it out a little bit, and so I'm going to turn the water on just for a second or two to flush this out. You'll get a big spray of water, and then we'll turn it off. Here's a closer look at the manual control bushing. This is the top, and that's the bottom. And you can see with the white paper clipping showing that there's an always open pathway between the top and the bottom. That's never sealed off. Now I've put a wire through this central pathway, and you can see in the central pathway on the top, which is this part, there's a little nipple, and the solenoid makes contact with that nipple. When the solenoid lifts off of it, water can flow down this central pathway. The bushing screws into the housing, and when it does, it makes contact with the seat on the other end. You can see there's a second raised nipple here that makes contact with that seat. Now, I think a professional would likely not waste his time to clean one of these things, but we're going to clean it anyway and just see if it makes a difference. You can get these, and they're relatively cheap and easily available, and so if you're at all concerned about the diaphragm, you can certainly replace it. There, that's quite a bit better. Let's put it back in now and see if it works. Let's clean the bonnet the same way. There's some little orifices here that need to be patent for this thing to work properly, and I'm going to show you those now. Here's a freeze frame of the undersurface of the bonnet. This nipple leads to the center hole under the manual control bushing, and this second hole leads to the side hole under the manual control bushing. A plug in either of these passages would cause the valve to stick closed, and you won't be able to open it with manual control either. In contrast, notice that if the solenoid fails, the valve will stay closed, but you should still be able to turn the sprinklers on by unscrewing the manual control bushing. So trying manual control can be a quick way to guide your investigation towards either an electrical problem or a mechanical problem with the valve. Even though the history of my sticking open valve doesn't suggest a problem here, with the diaphragm out of the way, now is a good time to probe these pathways as preventive maintenance. This other valve here goes to this manual decompression valve, and I undid that earlier. And then this one here is the flow control valve, and when you turn it clockwise, it's dials flow down, and it'll actually spin right out. I'll show you here, like that. It's got a little O-ring on it. Now you notice I'm being very careful to line up this prominence here with this hole. It only goes on one way. Now you noticed I used a drill to get them in, but the final torquing should be by hand and not too tight, and you do it in a crossways pattern in keeping with general practice. Now comes the manual control bushing. Now you want to make sure it slides on so that you've got room here at the end, you don't make contact, so it needs to be, when it's tight, it needs to be in a position where it, there, like that. So we'll put it right here so it doesn't meet this post here. There. Let's open it up and see if it works manually. One thing I should point out to you, there's a little O-ring. That's it right there. Don't lose that baby. This little O-ring goes right here over top of this thing. There it goes, right there in that little orifice right there. Well, I've got a universal set of O-rings, so I didn't bother to search for the lost O-ring. After I put the system together, it works fine, and presumably just cleaning the system was all it needed. I hope this video helped you with your repair. Thanks for watching.